So just a few words about this second piece, Borodin's second quartet. When we think of Alexander Borodin these days, we tend to think of him as a member of this group of like-minded, late 19th century St. Petersburg-based composers we know as the Mighty Five. Their mission was to create an uncorrupted, pure, idiosyncratic style of Russian music that could not be mistaken for watered-down Western European music. That was what they wanted to do. Most of them were not educated as musicians at all. They were educated in other professions. Many of them were military officers. Rimsky-Korsakov was a naval officer. And Borodin himself never really identified himself as a professional musician at all throughout his life. And rather famously, he called himself a Sunday composer, which is to say that he liked to write music on Sundays as a way of powering down from the demands of his day job, which was as the director of the chemistry department at the Medical Surgical Academy of St. Petersburg. He was one of the most esteemed teachers of chemistry and professors and researchers of the time. And even today, chemists think of him more as the man who did groundbreaking work in the nature of aldehydes than as a composer. He was a man who could do pretty much anything that he set his mind out to do. Spoke four languages fluently. And he had a profound social conscience as well. He is remembered as having opened up the doors of the Medical Surgical Academy there in St. Petersburg for the first time ever to female students so that young women could come and they could study medicine alongside all of these grim-looking men. He himself graduated from this institution with his doctorate in the late 1850s. And then he felt that he needed to expand his horizons a bit. So he went off and did his postdoctoral work for 3 years at the University of Heidelberg in Germany. And this exposed him to scientific currents of thought in Europe and also, of course, to musical currents, which annoyed his friends in the Mighty Five. They didn't like the fact that he was consorting with Western musical currents. It was against their precepts and their mission. But he did it anyway. He loved the music of Beethoven, and he loved to play the cello in chamber music. And this further polarized the Mighty Five against him because they thought that chamber music was too rooted in the soil of Western European musical currents. And so eventually he just said, I'm going to do it anyway. And he became the only one of the Mighty Five to write any appreciable amount of chamber music, and truly great chamber music like the piece that we're about to hear. Now, while he was still living here in Heidelberg, he met a young Russian pianist whose name was Ekaterina Protopopova. And they fell madly in love with each other, and they were married not long after they met. And it was a very, very solid relationship, and they were deeply committed to each other. And rather sadly, he died early. He died at the age of 54 at a ball in St. Petersburg after the two of them had danced a particularly energetic waltz together. And apparently it was just too much for his heart and he collapsed on the floor and he was dead not long after that. She was so distraught and devastated by this that 6 months later she died as well. So this was a very committed and symbiotic and deeply loving relationship. And when he was 48 years old, he decided he would write a string quartet and dedicate it to her on the event of their 20th anniversary. And that's this piece we're about to hear. And because it has this very romantic backstory, We tend to hear it through the lens of that romantic story, and it has a kind of a programmatic subtext, according to some people. It is full of the most beautiful cello melodies you ever heard, right from the very beginning of the piece. And since he played the cello, people tend to decide that that is the musical voice of Borodin himself. And in looking for the musical voice of Ekaterina, they settle on the first violin because there are no pianos and string quartets. But I think it makes sense. And at the very beginning of the first movement of the piece, we hear this tender, loving dialogue between these two instruments, the musical voices of Alexander and Ekaterina, perhaps. And if you buy into this notion that there is this subtextual, programmatic relationship between the violin and the cello, then in the second movement, the second theme, I think it's very easy to imagine the two of them early in their courtship whirling across the dance room floor together to the tune of this very famous waltz, which much later became Baubles, Bangles, and Beads in the 1953 musical Kismet. I'm sure most of you recognize that tune. But I think the most instantly recognizable tune of all is heard in the cello again at the beginning of the third movement, very romantic movement called Nocturne or Notturno. And it's a melody that really is on everyone's short list of the 10 most beautiful melodies ever written. And I think it's also a tune that every musician on the planet wishes that Borodin had written for their own instrument. And I discovered this last week as I was ranging around in the internet reading up on this piece, and I kept stumbling across arrangements of this piece for various instrumental combinations. And finally, I thought the thing to do is to sew them all together into a 2-minute nocturno mashup, which I will play for you for your edification.
This is my beloved.
Strange spice from the south, honey through a comb sifting. Imagine these on one eager mouth. My beloved.
Vic Damone and Judy Garland were great Borodinians, as you see. So enjoy this absolutely gorgeous piece.